despite the vast number of disaster movies or articles discussing whether the Yellowstone supervolcano in Wyoming and Idaho will catastrophically erupt each year, we confidently know that it is currently incapable of producing any form of a volcanic eruption, including a very small one. We know this due to the nature of Yellowstone's massive magma chamber, which has been estimated to contain, depending on the source used, between 4,000 and 11,500 cubic kilometers of magma. In any given magma chamber, the magma is divided primarily into two categories, solid and melt. The solid magma represents semi-solidified to solidified rock full of crystals, which form due to its slow cooling at depth. If solidified magma was to exist in a basaltic composition magma chamber, it would form a rock type known as gabbro. In contrast, the melt represents what is typically associated when you try and picture magma, as, much like its name implies, it represents molten rock in a liquid state. At volcanoes around the planet, one way to determine if an imminent volcanic eruption is theoretically possible is to determine the percent makeup of a magma chamber in terms of melt and solid material. It is fairly well known that a section of a magma chamber needs to be at least 35% to 50% melt by volume to be theoretically capable of producing an eruption. Since the Yellowstone supervolcano's vast magma chamber contains somewhere between 5% and 15% melt, this means that it could not produce an eruption anytime soon unless a fairly fast and drastic change occurs in its magma chamber. This is why we do not believe that Yellowstone will erupt at any point in the next 1,000, perhaps 10,000 years. If you compare the maximum melt percentage measured at magma chambers in various volcanoes listed below, you will note that only the systems which are above the aforementioned 35% threshold have erupted at some point in the last 1,000 years. But then, a new scientific paper which is referenced on screen was published, and it showed something quite surprising. This paper suggests that Yellowstone's magma chamber melt percentage maximizes out at not 15%, but instead 28%. You might see this figure and say, well, what's the big deal? That figure is still below 35%. And you'd be correct, but there is a potential problem. You see, the Lone Valley supervolcano in California has less than or equal to 27% melt, and thus should be theoretically incapable of producing a volcanic eruption at the present. Yet, Mammoth Mountain, which under some definitions could theoretically be considered part of the Lone Valley Caldera, last produced an eruption via phreatic explosion a mere 700 years ago. Or, between 1980 and 1982, a batch of magma intruding underneath Mammoth Mountain advanced from a depth of 10 to 3 kilometers depth before it solidified, still remaining there today, and causing large amounts of carbon dioxide to seep onto the surface, forming dead tree zones on sections of the mountain. While this magma probably originated from a distinct magma chamber completely separate to the one at Lone Valley, in some models it was claimed to have originated from Lone Valley's magma chamber. Yet, if an eruption was theoretically not possible at Lone Valley, how did magma get so close to the surface? Therefore, we are left with a few possibilities. 1. Perhaps we have incorrectly estimated the amount of melt in the Lone Valley Caldera's magma chamber, and there exists somewhere a part of a magma chamber with greater than 35% by volume melt. Possibility 2 is that we have measured its melt correctly, but that our 35% threshold figure is wrong and might need to be lowered under certain conditions. Possibility 3 is the simplest explanation in my opinion, with the magmatic intrusion underneath Mammoth Mountain not representing a batch of magma from Lone Valley's magma chamber, but rather its own distinct magma chamber. With this under consideration, the new melt estimate on a section of Yellowstone's magma chamber in the new scientific paper is 1% higher than the maximum figure measured at Lone Valley. While this could theoretically indicate that Yellowstone is actually capable of producing an eruption in the near future, this would only be true if we were to grasp at straws and hope that a good deal of pre-existing science is incorrect on this topic. In other words, the new estimate, which was arrived at via a different methodology than other prior estimates, therefore making it not a perfect hard figure, is possibly high by a factor of 2, although it could be correct. Different prior papers had suggested a melt volume ranging from 5% to 20%. We simply do not know for sure which of these figures is the most accurate. So, despite the new estimate, it is still almost certain that the Yellowstone supervolcano will not erupt anytime soon, in my opinion. However, if the new estimate is correct, it suggests Yellowstone is closer to erupting than previously thought, although this still means its next eruption is likely thousands of years away, if not more. Thanks for watching. If you would like to request a specific topic, please leave a comment below. Additionally, I would like to thank my new patron, Linda E. Dewey, MD, for supporting this channel.